all the teachers and students, and my honorable speaker, our honorable speaker, Dr. Rini Dastidar, to our webinar series conducted by our NSS unit and jointly with IQAC, a special cell. I would like to thank you, Dr. Dastidar, and our unit members who have given a lot of effort to conduct this kind of webinar, which is the topic of which is very much pertinent and relevant in these days. I'm sure that students are also participating for whom this webinar is actually arranged. And I'm sure that we will be enriched from Dr. Dastidar, and this session will be a successful one. Now I would like to request our convener, madam, to conduct the session. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Am I audible? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you, madam. Along with principal, madam, I, as a convener of this committee, welcome all our distinguished audiences and especially our eminent speaker, Dr. Rinini Dastidar. Our speaker, Dr. Dastidar, is associated with Ramakrishna Mission Seva Pratishthan, Vivekananda Institute of Medical Sciences, for the last 12 years. Presently, she is a professor and in charge of Department of Biochemistry. Previously, she also worked as an assistant professor in Department of Biotechnology or Molecular Biology. She did her graduation from Bethune College and post-graduation and a PhD in biochemistry. She did her research work in eminent institutions like Bosch Institute and IIT Kharagpur. Later, she started working on human genetics and related disorders. She worked as a DNA analyst in Orchid Biosciences, Oxford, UK. And now she is associated with many famous eminent institutions of our city. So I welcome Dr. Dastidar once again, and I request her to deliberate her speech and enrich us. Thank you, Dr. Dastidar.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, madam.
Okay. So good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon. It's a proud privilege for me to be here amongst you. I thank all the organizers, respected dignitaries, respected principal madam, convener madam, and all other esteemed audience and dear students. So it's really an honor for me to be invited in this prestigious platform to share my views on a very, very pertinent topic, that is blood transfusion. And of course, now we know that this whole world is turning upside down due to COVID-19 pandemic. So taking a corollary to the pandemic and blood transfusion, it is basically a knowledge updation for me as well. Very little has been known or very little has been published regarding this too. So it's a very good topic. So I feel very honored to get a chance to share my views on the topic. So I'm just going straightly to the lecture. So I'm sharing my screen. Just please tell me whether you are able to see my screen.
Okay, madam, we'll convey it.
Okay, is it now visible? I have shared my screen. Is it now visible?
No, it's not visible. Still now, it's not visible.
It's not, but in my computer, it is showing that stop sharing. So, anybody else in the meeting, it's not visible to anyone?
Is it visible to anyone?
No, no, madam. No, madam.
No, no.
No, it is not visible to us.
Okay.
It's not visible to us.
Just 1 minute. I'm just doing it again. Can't share your screen. Error has occurred. So this is. Is it now visible?
Yeah,
hello.
Now
yes,
yes,
ma'am. Yes,
now
yes,
it's visible, ma'am.
Is it now visible?
Yes, yeah, madam.
Madam.
It's now visible. It's now visible, ma'am.
Hello.
Hello, madam. It's visible.
Okay, okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Okay, let us start my topic. It is the blood transfusion and its relevance to COVID-19 pandemic. So the starting just. So what I will deliver, so topics at a glance. So we will just discuss about the definition and what are the basic requirements of blood transfusion and why it is required. And we know that for blood transfusion, blood donations are very important. So what are the stringent criteria for screening of blood donations? We know all know about blood donations, but not only the whole blood, but all the blood components that are being transfused to the requisite amount to the patients. So I will discuss on that. It is also very important, not only the after collecting blood from the donor to the blood bank, the transportation and the storage of the blood components and the blood is very important, because if the storage temperature is not maintained, if it is not stored properly, then the transfusion of the blood will be totally ineffective, or it may elicit any kind of adverse reactions, which is not advisable. So the storage is very important. Administration of blood product, how it to be administered, and what are the indications, that means when it is required, and what are the contraindications, that is a terminology is very much coined in medical science, that what are the contraindications, that means in a state where the state of a patient when transfusion of blood, or you can say that administering any medicine is not advised. So we will discuss about that. Most importantly, adverse effects of blood transfusion. It could be fatal if the adverse, the consequences of the blood transfusions, if it is not addressed, it could be fatal. It could take a life instead of saving life of the patients. So we will give a look on that, and definitely relevance of blood transfusion in COVID-19. Why it is it safe to transfuse blood in this pandemic? Because we know that we can defer some elective surgeries might be requiring blood, but there are many patients, they are requiring blood every time on a regular interval. So pandemic cannot restrict blood donation, blood transfusions to them. So how much it is safe? Second point in relevance to COVID-19, we will discuss about the convalescent plasma therapy that has been coined as a, that has been more or less it has been accepted, but there are many arguments and debates regarding this, that convalescent plasma therapy as a very promising and therapeutic approach to the patients of the COVID-19. And challenges of the CP therapy and some frequently asked question in context of the CP therapy, that will be covered in my lecture. So straightly just what is the definitions of blood transfusion. For in a very simplified way, that is, it is transferring the whole blood or blood components from donor to the recipient who requires it and who donates it. Here, one thing we have to keep in our mind, it is also a social responsibility for us, all of us, because transfusion of blood and products, blood products, should be undertaken to treat a condition, serious condition, might be severely associated with morbidity and mortality, when the situations cannot be prevented by any other effective means. That means blood transfusion should be opted only then when it is urgently required, not others. Secondly, why it is required? We should know when it is required. So we know there are some inherited blood diseases, just like thalassemia, you know, sickle cell anemia, hemophilia. These diseases are the inherited blood diseases, disorders, and these are happen due to the change of this mutation, change of the DNA sequences or mutations, and it requires transfusion. Because in these disorders, hemoglobin production is very low due to some point mutations. We know sickle cell anemia, we have been reading since our childhood days that instead of point mutation, instead of glutamic acid, it changes to valine. So we all about, we know all about the diseases, and this is the acute, this is very important. Hemolytic anemia of newborn. Sometimes we get patients in our hospitals due to RH incompatibility, the newborns gets the hemolytic anemia. So there also blood transfusion is very important, and it has to be the transfusion procedure and the whole management of these has to be taken in a very, very serious. Recently, we got a case of the HDN of newborn, and we have seen, though I'm not from transfusion medicine, but since I'm in biochemistry, but sometimes we get how the other biochemical parameters also get distorted or abnormal due to this, and how the blood requirements save the child. So this is, we get an exposure to this. Post-traumatic or operative cases which bleeds, if the patient bleeds, then it requires malignancy, leukemia, in case here the blood transfusion is very common. Kidney failure or hepatic coma, where the important components of blood is impaired. So in that cases, it is required. In case of pregnancy, sometimes postpartum delivery or sometimes at the time of delivery, the patient bleeds. There also we feel the urgency of the blood transfusion. And nonetheless, that if anybody is just suffering from accidents, then the emergency cases, so how the blood transfusion or blood requirements are done, so we all know about that. So we should stick to the principles of clinical transfusion practice. So the principles have been taken from the AABB standards, that is American Association of the Blood Bank, or we means the blood bank of the Ramakrishna Mission Seva Pratishthan. I will show you the structures and the equipments. It is a very equipped blood bank. And so I have taken the principles from the SOPs and the standard guidelines, technical manual from our blood bank. What is that? So most importantly, the hemoglobin should not be the sole deciding value. Deciding factor to transfuse blood. Clinicians who requisite blood or who advises the blood transfusion, they have to be aware of the blood transfusion related hazards or the chances of transfusion transmissible infections, that is called TTI. That means hepatitis B, hepatitis C, syphilis, this kind of these infections might occur. So they should be keep in their minds that if this kind of infections occurs or if this adverse reaction occurs, how to deal with that, how to manage with that. And here this thing, this point I would like to emphasize, because if it is that they clearly record, they clearly write in a proper, good, clear handwriting, that is the reason for ordering a transfusion. Clinical diagnosis, it is very important. It's not likely that a clinician, a patient needs the transfusion, clinician orders, and it's done. So sometimes the transfusion expert, transfusion medicine expert, the blood professionals, they have many things to say. They have many things to guide the clinicians, what to transfuse, how to transfuse, and they need a discussion with the clinicians. And if there if it is not properly recorded, if it is not properly written, sometimes the transfusion might be fatal or erroneous. Technical staff should be very, very trained. They should be experienced, they should be knowledgeable of the whole procedures and the adverse reactions of the whole thing. So clinicians and the personnel, blood personnel, they should be very much, they should look after the transfusion procedure, whether it is there any anomalies going on, if the patient is showing any symptoms. So they should take care of that. So World Health Organization, they have guided some initiative. They have recorded some initiative. They clearly says that collection of the blood from the voluntary donors, from the low-risk populations. Definitely, I don't need to mention that. I don't need to make you understand the low-risk. That means if a area which is endemic in malaria, so it is not recommended to organize a blood donation camp from there. So, and one more thing, it is that non-remunerated donors. It is very important because we know that very unhealthy practices going on. So here, who has clearly said that the donor, whenever he or she donates blood, it should be utilized for the patient's benefit. It is for saving life, but not for the for making money, or should not get involved in any kind of business. Secondly, screening of the all donated blood for transfusion transmissible infections, that is HIV, HBV, CV, syphilis, and malaria, they are to be screened in the blood, the donated blood, that I will discuss. One more important thing here, it is written, that is the good laboratory practice. What does it mean by that? GLP, or sometimes it is for clinicians, it is GCP, good clinical practice. It is a very, very important term. Why? Because it encompasses the whole thing, that the practices in the lab, that has to be good in all senses. Pre-analytical, analytical, and post-analytical, these three phases are basically in the lab. So if the pre-analytical, in context of the blood transfusion, if in pre-analytical case, if the requisition is improper, somebody requires A plus, or somebody's group is A plus, it's written B plus, so it is basically the pre-analytical error. And the analytical phase is just encompasses this compatibility testing, blood grouping, component preparation, storage, transportation of the blood. So these are all these analytical, and post-transportation of blood includes under pre-analytical. And the post-analytical means after getting or doing all the tests, the results should be conveyed in a clear way, in a correct way, in an accurate way. Otherwise, so GLP should be the ethics of any lab, and especially its blood plan. reduction of unnecessary transfusions is very, very strictly monitored, because if it is unnecessary, those who don't need, we are transfusing them. So it leads to the shortage of blood bank. And we read in the newspapers, and we are in the, those who are in the hospitals, we feel that sometimes due to the shortage of blood.
Excuse me, ma'am, sorry to interrupt you, but the PPT slides are not moving. It's just, it has stand still.
It's not moving.
No.
It's not moving.
No, only the blood transfusion definition, that slide is on the screen.
Why?
It's not rolling. It's not rolling, actually.
Why it is happening? It should be.
So now it's coming, screening of blood donation.
So, okay, so I'm just doing that.
Okay, ma'am.
So now it is, you can see this, who blood yeah. said.
Yes, ma'am. Now we can see it.
Okay. So for two thistles, is it clear? I don't know. Thank you for making it clear. Okay. So now this reduction of the unnecessary transfusions, that through inappropriate clinical use is very important, because if we do not get the correct requisition, if we do not monitor it clearly, then it would be shortage of the blood, and it will definitely causes the crisis of blood. Now, this is the screening of the blood donation. So is it visible now? The slide is visible now?
Yes, madam, it's visible.
Okay, thank you very much. So now the screening, there should be screening criteria. Why it is important? What is the objective of screening? Because to detect the markers of infections, is there any infections in the donated blood? Or if there are anything else in the prevent the release of the infected blood and blood components for clinical use, that is the main objective. So here, I'm not repeating this. This thing is important, that laboratory testing, self-exclusion and deferral. So that these things, these points I am explaining in the next slide, so I'm not repeating this. So these are the basic points we should take into while screening the blood. So now, this blood donor recruitment, so the donor, shall appear to be in good physical and mental health. Age should lie in 18 to 60 years. Hemoglobin level should not be less than 12.5 for males. For females, it should not be less than 11.5. Weight should not be less than 45 kg. Systolic and diastolic blood pressure, it is clearly indicated that 100 to 140 in the systolic and 60 to 90 in the diastolic. But here it is it needs to be mentioned that it is the systolic and diastolic blood pressure should be maintained without the aid of any antihypertensive medicines. If a person, sometimes it's a misnomer. People think, my pressure is okay, so I'm eligible for donation. The answer is no, as per the guidelines. If you are under antihypertensive medication, so you cannot give. It is not recommended. So the temperature, oral temperature, if it is recorded, if a person is feverish or has fever, is not recommended. 99 point, if a person having the oral temperature above 99.5, so it's not recommended. Pulse should be 60 to 100. And the donation level, it should be 3 to 4 months. Now, so the instructions is that, we know that many blood donation camps are being organized, and it is a very, very important and good social responsibility who organize the blood donation camps. So some instructions they should follow. One is that, so they should screen rather, that if a person donor is fasting more than 4 hours, then the donor is offer should be offered some light meals, or if a person consumes alcohol, so next 24 hours he or she is not permitted to donate blood. If a person is having jaundice, typhoid, malaria, or rubella, so I'm just mentioning this, it's clearly indicated if you go by the any standard. So there are so many diseases, and when they can give blood after the onset of the diseases, even after the remission of the diseases, after then when they can next donate blood, you can get. Persons, those who had undergoing surgery, is not advised to donate blood at least for 6 months. Here, another important thing, that anticoagulant is to blood ratio. So 1:7 should be the prescribed ratio, and it has to be rigorously maintained. If the anticoagulant ratio is very high, so or it is very low, then it would be very difficult, because it will give the erroneous test results. So whenever the test results anomalies will come, then it would be very difficult to introspect what happened. So those who raise blood collected, they should have this idea of the ratio. Usually 450 ml blood is donated, and this is, if you have a look on this slide, this is the questionnaire form. In our hospital also, we are just given this questionnaires. It's a long questionnaire. I'm not going into details of that, but this kind of questions usually asked, that how are you today, what food you have taken, last donation, when you did the last donation, do you have any major illness, or did you have any vaccination, when did you last vaccinate, or do you have any tooth extractions, or are you pregnant, or are you breastfed mother, or are you menstruating? So this kind of, do you have any history of drug abuse? So this kind of questions are being asked. Not acceptable. So these persons or these diseases, not acceptable. What is that? Under influence of drugs and alcohol. Those who are the alcoholic, malignancy is not permanently deferred. Cardiovascular diseases, even bypass surgery, open heart surgery, they are permanently deferred for donation. Epileptic patients are totally deferred. Renal disease, TB, abnormal bleeding, these are the things. Lactating mothers are not encouraged for the lactation period. Similarly, pregnant mothers within after delivery, they should not donate blood within 1 year. And diabetes is a thing more frequently asked questions, because we know that every common household now we are having diabetic people. So now the question comes, that if a person is diabetic, are they permanently deferred for blood donation? So the guidelines suggest that if a person is diabetic but well controlled under oral hyperglycemic drug, then it is okay. And but if the person is under insulin, it is not advised to donate blood. Similarly, hypothyroidism and hyperthyroidism. So we commonly term is that thyroid disorders. So it is indicated that the persons having hypo and hyper, they are not allowed to donate blood. But sometimes very autoimmune hypothyroidism, or we can say subclinical hypothyroidism, when the TSH level is less than 10 or not any on thyroid medication they can give. Psychiatric diseases is the patients who are undergoing the psychiatric problems, they are not allowed to donate blood. So if you have just a small slide, it's a long list. Telling you just the abortion, after an abortion, 6 months different. We should know it. Otherwise, it's a, whenever many of us feeling enthusiastic to donate, but including myself, but we should know that when we should self-exclude. So for self-exclusion, we should know the criteria. So see the abortion. So if a lady has undergone abortion, she should self-exclude for 6 months for blood donation. Or if the history of blood transfusion is there, if a person might feel enthusiastic that I am saved, somebody has saved my life, so it is my moral responsibility to save others' life by donating my blood. So, but they should not give blood for 6 months. Similarly, for the students, I can say that tattoo is a style thing, icon, these things. But if anybody is doing or ornamenting tattoos on their bodies, they are deferred for blood donation for 3 years. History of hepatitis is 12 months. So these are the deferral things. Now coming to the blood components. So blood components, we are knowing that blood donation, that means collecting blood into the bag, we see the red liquid. So that is blood and that is to be transfused. But now what happens, not only whole blood, the blood components also plays a very important role. Why? Somebody might require, that is PRBC, packed red blood cell. He might not require platelet, or he might not require this plasma. So for that person, we can give the PRBC. Or someone is a burn patient, he requires the plasma. So no point of giving the whole blood or the PRBC. They should give the plasma. Severely, there are many diseases which requires a specific component. So now blood bank is oriented with these things, and they are doing component separation instruments and procedures are there, and they are making the components. After collecting blood, they are within 6 hours, they are separating it into different components, and they are stored into the or refrigerated as per the guidelines and maintaining the whole procedure. And whenever whichever is required, they then this requisition takes and gives that. So here we can say just an idea to have an idea for a 500 ml whole blood, you can get this 200 ml RBC, packed RBC. So it is preserved with ADSOL. It's a preservant. So it is adenine, dextrose, sorbitol, sodium chloride, mannitol. So ADSOL is a preservative. It is available in the market. So they are making these and adding this preserve. And then we know that it is platelet-rich plasma when it is centrifuged, platelets and plasma. So the persons who are, I will show you in the next slides that where these platelets is required. So those persons' platelets could be transfused. Someone might require the cryoprecipitate. I have read that some COVID-19 cases, cryoprecipitate is there required. So they give the cryoprecipitate. So this is very important, that component separation. So you just have a look on that. The procedure is a schematic diagram, how the components are separated. See, it's a whole blood centrifuged. If a patient requires that, you directly transfuse that. If it is two different components, whole plasma, packed RBCs. Packed RBCs, someone requires in case of the acute blood loss, you can give that. For whole plasma, packed RBCs is mostly requisitioned blood products. Whole plasma, if it is give a heart spin, platelet poor plasma, if it is frozen to minus 25, it is FFP. Sometimes clinician advises FFP transfusion. So blood bank then gives that. For FFP, after centrifugation, the precipitate is the cryoprecipitate, and the supernatant is called cryosupernatant, and that is enriched in the immunoglobulin. So now, one more term here we can see, it is the plasmapheresis. What is that? In our hospital also, it is being done. That is a very good way that whenever the blood is collected, then it is going through a machine. In a simplified way, it is going through a machine, and the requisite component which is required, that is transfused to the patient. Otherwise, the rest of the things is going back to the patient's blood. So it's not required. So this is an equipment. It is a very, very expensive equipment. So RKM has this. RKM's blood bank is a very equipped blood bank. So it is a Terumo, that means Terumo Purple is a manufacturer. So it is an automatic component extractor. The model number is this. It is basically automated blood standardized processing of the blood components. You know what is the use of that? Because sometimes the requisition of the blood products is very high, but due to technical staff shortage or due to time shortage, the component separation procedures cannot be done in time. Then this automated processor comes into the picture. So the frequency is the key. When we can see, give the blood, whole blood, we can every 56 days you can give, platelet 24 times you can, plasma 13 times a year, double red cells, it is the 3 times a year. Now, this is a thing, it might be a bit tough for the students, and it is this area falls under strictly in the area of the transfusion medicine expert, because it is totally medical things. But I just want to give an idea to you students that when these components are given and when it should not be given. So indications means whole blood indications, mean in these conditions of the patients who has acute blood loss or exchange transfusion, in case of the babies, we get newborn babies with 30, 40, even 50 bilirubin. So there is a high chance of carny icterus. So then immediately we call, inform to the clinicians, and they then contact the blood bank, and the babies are put under exchange transfusion. And in biochemistry department, they give pre-exchange blood and post-exchange blood to monitor whether the transfusion is okay. But whenever contraindications means when it is not recommended. If a person is reeks of volume overloaded, that is circulatory overload, is a adverse reaction of the transfusion. Chronic anemia, or who are giving the getting the transfusion, or the incipient cardiac failure. So in those cases, this whole blood transfusion is not recommended, or if it is done, then it has to be scrutinized strictly by the transfusion medicine expert and the concerned clinician. So we know that here I'm not repeating it, because these are ABO compatible, RHD compatible. You know, I'm going into the next slide. I will discuss it in the next slide. So I'm not repeating or explaining these slides. Just here also, these are mostly medical terminologies there, that if a fresh frozen plasma, when it is given, so replacement of a single coagulation factor deficiency, then it is requisitioned. And it should be ABO compatible, it should be infused as soon as possible, and it should be thawing procedures is also very important. Or when it is not recommended, when massive blood transfusion is recommended, if there is acute DIC, that is decimated intravascular coagulation, when the patient develops blood clots all over body, or very coagulation factor abnormalities, then FFP transfusion is contraindicated. So this is all about these things. This is about cryoprecipitate, but cryoprecipitation, this anti-hemophilic factor requisition is very less. Now I'm showing you you might be feeling interested of the equipments that is in the blood bank, how the blood bank looks. So this is a chamber. So we have many chambers in the blood bank. It's a very big area, large area, compartmentalized. So there are many fridges, and you know, unique refrigeration technique, blood center refrigerator. So you can see, students, you can feel that refrigerator, what is big deal in that? Why, madam, you are telling so many things? Let me tell you, refrigerator is a thing that is, you need the temperature maintenance. You need to monitor the temperature fluctuations. You need to calibrate this refrigerator temperature every time as per the manufacturer's advice. Otherwise, this refrigerator, it looks like it's working fine, but the stored products, especially in context of the blood products, it will deteriorate it. It will deteriorate, and it will, whenever this deteriorated blood product will be transfused, it will produce adverse reactions. But you are completely might be unaware of the fact. You might feel that I have stored the products, but why it will elicit? Sometimes we get the patients that they are having these problems. So I will discuss that. So this is centrifuge, and this is cryocentrifuge. That is the cool centrifuge. It is also a very, very expensive instrument, and it is basically used to prepare PRBC, platelet-rich plasma, concentrated, cryoprecipitate. It is very, very important and a very expensive procedure, expensive instruments. This is the minus 40. This is ELISA. So you might have read in your theory that is ELISA. ELISA, enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay. So we are doing ELISA, blood bank, doing routine ELISA, because all the transmissible diseases, that is transfusion transmissible diseases, that is we can say the HIV or sometimes we HCV, these are being done by the ELISA. Whenever ELISA is done massively or in a bulk way, then it is very difficult to do it manually. So we do some part manual, but washing, those who have practical experience of doing ELISA, they know that washing is a very important procedure, step of ELISA. And if the washing is not done properly, then it is very difficult to remove the unbound antigen or antibody. So washing, we have the automated washer. So it might sound that it's not that much why it is required, but whenever you are going to do ELISA, then only you can remember, or you might require the urgency of having an automated washer. This is laminar flow. Most of the, you might have seen this one because it is there in many colleges in the microbiology section. This is the other things, that is platelet incubator and agitator. So platelets, when are stored, it has to be in incubator 20 to 24 degrees centigrade, constant agitation. So this is platelet incubator, and this is just a small room where if a person is lying over there and just taking blood donation for collections. So this is a room, this chair is there. So this is a small thing. Now coming to this storage, blood cold chain, you know, this slide, why it is very important, that cold chain maintenance is a very key point. Why? You might have organized the blood donation camps. It might happen that around the year, many voluntary organizations, they are organizing blood donation camp. But sometimes the blood bank professionals, before these presentations, we had frequent conversations with the blood bank professionals. So they used to tell me that sometimes even after having the proper, maintaining the proper protocol, blood is collected. Blood, since it is not stored or since it is not maintained cold chain during transportation, these blood products are getting, have got deteriorated. So storage is very important. So this is the storage temperature for platelet. If it is FFP, then minus 30. If it is platelet component, plus 20 to 24. If it is blood cell component, 2 to 6. It is very important. So you have to take care of this. Even if it happens that after collecting blood, it is not possible to send to the blood bank in a short way, or in the as per standard, it should reach the blood bank within 4 hours. But it might happen. It might happen that you are not able to carry your blood products to the blood bank within the prescribed time. In that case, you might store your blood in the quarantine center. Then quarantine storage should also follow the guidelines. Now coming to these tests. So blood is collected, you have maintained the cold chain temperature, that is 2 to 4 degrees centigrade. Blood products have reached the lab blood bank. Then you have the standard operating procedures following. You have separated the components and you stored into the respective fridges or where it is advised. Now it has to be screened. What screening is there? Tests prior to transfusion. What is that? Basically ABO and RHD group testing, patients and donors. Okay. Secondly, if there any presence of any irregular antibody, then you need to screen. Third important point is that cross matching. So sometimes we are synonymizing the things, that cross matching and compatibility testing, both are same, but it is not. Compatibility testing includes these three, and cross matching is one of these tests. So here in these slides, you all know what is ABO typing. So for A blood group, A antigen, anti B. So for B, so I'm not going into details of this ABO typing. I know that you, all of you, are very much aware of this cell, this how this is done. So in the slide, it is that anti-A serum, anti-B serum, and anti-AB serum is there, and you put the patient blood, a donor's blood is there, and if it is agglutination, so the specific blood group is present. So you know that. And one is that positive negative RHD typing. That is also very common. That is, it is why it is important, because RHD antigen is the most immunogenic of the Rh antigen. So RHD typing. And it is very important to ABO in clinical significance. So you know that this RHD type of D measurement or RHD typing, why it plays so much clinical importance, because you know the erythroblastosis, fetalist reactions, or we can say that hemolytic disease of the fetus. If a mother is Rh negative and the fetus is Rh positive, in the first case the baby might say, but in the second case, if the mother is already sensitized with the Rh positive fetus, then in second case of conception the baby might not be saved. So that is also a very important thing you should know. So here is a slide. There you can see that what kind of blood group is there, a blood type, and whom you can donate blood, and where, from whom you can receive blood. So nothing, so this is all about that. And one more thing, it is antibody screening test. If there any irregular antibody is there, because so many antigens are there, so if any irregular antibodies are elicited against the RBC antigen, you never know. So for that, direct Coombe test and indirect Coombe test is done. So for this direct Coombe test, we are this patient's blood with this that blood is taken from a patient, and here also the immune mediated antibody is there. So RBC antigen is already attached to this antibody. And whenever the patient blood is added, the patient washed blood, and here it is Coombe reagent. If the Coombe reagent is added, then it is attached to this antigen antibody complex. And ultimately, if the agglutination is there, then it is the direct test. Or indirect test, when it is for screening the outside, that means it is the recipient serum, it is the IgG antibody rich patient's donor cell, and here it is whenever this donor cell is added to the patient's serum, then it is attached to that. And if then Coombe's reagent is added, anti-human antibody, if agglutination occurs, you see the agglutination here. So then it is direct positive indirect test. I don't know why my slideshow is not working. So if I can show the slides in the slideshow, that would be better, I feel. But I don't know why it is not working. So now the most important thing is that cross-matching. Cross-matching is other important thing, major and minor cross-match. Major, so just let me explain with this pictorial depiction that it'd be easier for the students, is that major cross-matching is there, that recipient's serum and donor's RBC. One drop of donor RBC and two drops of recipient serum. It is incubated for 37 degrees centigrade, and then add some two drops of anti-human globulin. If the agglutination occurs, then you cannot give this, not compatible for transfusion. And no agglutination, it is compatible. Similarly, in case of the minor cross-match, instead of taking donor's RBC, here donor's serum is that, and recipient's RBC. Same procedure is following. Only the difference is that here donor's serum is taken in spite of donor's blood cell. If agglutination is occurring after the same procedure, then it is not compatible, or no agglutination, it is compatible. So it is basically we are doing the testing donor cell with recipient serum to determine the presence of any antibody which causes hemolysis of the donor cells. Similarly, in the reverse way, minor cross-match, donor's plasma with the recipient cell to detect the presence of any antibody which may cause hemolysis or agglutination of the recipient cell. So both donors and recipients, we are tested so that to minimize or to prevent any kind of adverse reactions, or the it is compatibility testing and cross-matching is very important to save life. Now, other things, it is the heart of any lab, that is quality control. So I'm not going into the details of that. I am just explaining, we are taking a single thing, that is the whole blood. Now let me tell that quality control, it encompasses the quality assurance. What does it mean? That whenever a patient goes to a doctor and doctor recommends or requires some tests, the patient goes to the laboratory and they get the reports. Now, sometimes it is a very common thing that we hear that that lab is bad, that lab delivers bad reports, that lab is good. So how the goodness or badness is decided? So there are some accreditation bodies in case of it is AABB or NBTC or NABH for blood bank accreditation bodies. They give that particular blood bank license to donate the requisite blood amount or the components for transfusion. For that, you need to know that whether the lab complies the accreditation criteria. Say for blood bank, these are specific. for other banks, NABL, National Accreditation Board for Testing. So it is a national body. It is the Quality Council of India. It's a national body. It accredits a particular lab. Say we need the sugar report, glucose report, or LFT report. We go to a lab and we get the, how could we decide? So if a lab is accredited and some assessors or accreditation assess the lab, whether the lab complying by the standards. Similarly, in the blood bank also, there are some standards. So 1% of the total blood collected, they are giving this criteria. What criteria? For whole blood, volume should be this. So you have to take a particular bag and you have to screen the sterility. That whether it is by culture, whether there is any growth or no growth. If there is no growth, very good. If it is negative serology, that means you have screened all transmissible diseases by serological reactions. Negative serology, very good, that no infective things are present. Your HCT should be greater than 30%. So this is the criteria. If that particular bag, 1% of the total bags collected, so you need to comply. If it is there, so it is okay. There are some transfusion guidelines. The most recent one I have taken from the net, it is that 2019, but the blood bank in charge the other day told me it has been updated in 2021. American Association of Blood Banks are there. So many other blood bank, other standards are there. I'm not going into details of that. So you have to follow. The other important thing, very, very important thing, that checkpoints, that deterioration in blood and plasma. So have a look on this picture. So are there any leaks? Look for the hemolysis of the plasma. Look for the, is there any clot in the plasma? Is the color seems to be more red? Or purple or pink, what is that? Any sign of contamination, such a change of color in the red cells. If you observe, if the blood bank technologists, they observe the change of color, or if they detect any clot in plasma, then they say that this bag cannot be used for transfusion. If by chance, erroneously, this faulty bag is transfused to a patient, it might lead to a very, very bad adverse reactions. Now coming to the adverse reactions. So it is the very fatal things. See, we are transfusing blood. We are maintaining all criteria. We have selected donors maintaining the standards. But main aim of this to save the life. Despite all the things, if the adverse reaction occurs, then instead of saving a patient's life, we are making the patient more fatal and it might lead to death. So in that cases, first thing is that stop transfusion immediately and report immediately to the transfusion center, blood bank, or usually it is 1 to 2% occurrence we see, or any bacterial contaminations on the red cells, or is there any under-recognized cause of acute transfusion? You don't know, na? If the deterioration of the bag is there, if the bag is contaminated, so that time it was missed, but this time whenever it is started transfusion to the patient, then it will not be the patient might not be that much lucky to bypass this, so might have some reactions. So this is what we can say, that just this is a pictorial representations of the hazards of the blood transfusion. It might be two types, acute or delayed. So transfusion reactions, if it is occurs less than 24 hours, it is early. And if it is delayed, so greater than 24 hours. So two types are there, immunologic and non-immunologic. So bacterial contaminations, circulatory overload, chemical or physical hemolysis that falls under non-immunologic transfusion reactions, or this immunologic is hemolytic, it is very fatal. Febrile non-hemolytic, it can be managed. Usually in category 1 allergic reactions is observed, but not that much fatal. Transfusion related acute lung injury, that is called TRAIL, that is very, very fatal. In case of the delayed, you know that immunologic is there, that it is delayed. That means that time it, the patient might not feel, but in the delayed, that means within 1 month or after 14 to 15 days, might be 7-8 days. So there is a rejection post-transfusion purpura. So these are basically the transfusion relates, transfusion related hazards. So now this is absolutely under the clinician's purview. I'm just putting this in the discussions to have an idea that what kind of, when they have categorized these adverse reactions into 3, that it is the stage 1 or mild reactions, it is localized or urticaria, that means the pruritus, the itching sign. So it is due to the hypersensitivity. So usually they give the antihistamine and observe for 30 minutes. If it is symptoms are mitigated, then it is okay. They continue transfusion. If it is not mitigated, they categorize it as a second one. So these are the second one. So anxiety, pruritus, palpitations, mild dyspnea, that is the shortness of breath, headache, these kind of things. So I'm not going into the details of these, what medicines to be given, because no point of discussing here. It is absolutely the falls under the purview of the transfusion medicine expert and the clinician, but only steroids, corticosteroids and antihistamine, they are preliminary given. And what they do, that they are sending the blood samples and urine samples of the patients to the blood bank then immediately to check whether there is any incompatibility. And category 3 is very, very dangerous. Patient might be dead. So that is the life-threatening reactions. Chest pain, patient develops the chest pain, respiratory distress, back pain, or the tachycardia when it is rise 20% in the heart rate, hemoglobinuria, hypotension is very fatal when the systolic BP falls under 20. So in that cases, might be there are some intravascular hemolysis. It might be due to mismatched blood transfusion. So it is immediately, it should be immediately addressed. Otherwise, the patient might be dead. So I'm not going into details of that, because the transfusion should be stopped with an immediate effect. It should be reported to the blood bank or the doctors, and the responding, the treating clinicians should maintain the patient's thermodynamic or vital parameters, and whatever needed, the doctors will do that. Now, coming to the new topic, as at least for me, that how this blood transfusion is related to the COVID-19. The thing is that how much safe is blood transfusion in COVID-19? So you know that firstly, it was thought that COVID-19 dispersion rate is very low, but we know it is not. And very pathetic experience of the second wave, especially. We have lost our near and dear ones. We have seen how this the whole country is getting affected. So my point is that here the pandemic is reigning over the world, but sometimes that you cannot postpone the surgery. Cancer patients, say the thalassemic patients, sickle cell patients, or the pregnant patient who needs transfusion. So there is a backdrop fear is there, that whether is it safe to get blood, which blood bank is safe. So there is so many fears into our mind. So I have taken some journals. It is that Future Science Way. It is the 2020. It is basically a the Italian study, and they said that what is that current clinical practice in absence of guidelines. So the paper said, the paper suggested that for ensuring safety of the international community, recommends self-deference of donors, inexposed or symptomatic COVID-19 patients for 28 days. Here comes the importance of the social responsibility. So I might be an enthusiastic donor, but later on I realized that I have exposed to a person who later on developed COVID-19 symptoms. So I myself defer myself for donation at least for 28 days. Secondly, if the blood is collected for the persons who is exposed to the COVID-19, blood bank should take the responsibility not to deliver the blood product even in case of urgency. They should quarantine the blood products till the donor is considered safe, defined by the absence of subsequent illness. So that is the responsibility of the blood bank. Sometimes, if the donor is found to be COVID-19 positive, or if it develops some symptoms, then they should recall the blood products. So it is very, very important for a lab. So challenges of having blood donation from asymptomatic COVID-19 patients in pandemic situations. See, many patients are there who do not see, show any symptoms. So how could they be treated, that whether they are, because they are not showing any symptoms. We have every time since I'm in a medical institute, so we are not that much privileged to be here. So every day we need to go to our department. There is a high chance of contaminations, and we have seen, I have my personal experience, that the technicians or the person I am talking to, the next very day he's getting positive and he's admitted. So every time we are in the fear. But so it is very difficult, and for the blood donation purposes, it is very difficult. It is really challenging to get a blood from the asymptomatic COVID patients. So because why the challenge is? Because viral RNA likely to be undetectable by RT-PCR in nasopharyngeal swab before the onset of symptoms. So no question, RT-PCR, if it is done, so it comes negative. Second, serological conversions, it occurs third to fourth week after the onset of symptoms. So serological tests, if it is done, so it comes negative. That does not necessarily rule out the possibilities of having the disease. Number three, asymptomatic donors is how could you know? So this is not recommended. As per some published reports, so I have seen the International Journal of Infective Public Health or VOXANG. So these are the very, very few publications are there. So I have got, that is, these are ahead of print, 2020, both the publications. They basically thrive on the COVID-19 transmission and the blood transfusion. So see, what these reports say, whenever I have gone through the reason, they said that it is safe. Why? They said that the viral load in the asymptomatic person is insufficient to transmit the infection to the blood recipients. So it is very, very, it is a line of hope. Two, three, four more slides are there, that convulsing therapy. All of us are very much aware of that. It is a very, very promising therapeutic approach. What is that? If a person which is after these 14 days or 11 days of getting PCR negative report, this COVID-19 patients recovered, then they can serve as a donor for his plasma. It is rich in IgG antibodies. And this plasma has to be ABO matched with the COVID-19 patients, other COVID-19 patients. So the circulatory antibody then bind to the AGE receptor, angiotensin converting receptors of the patients, and inhibit or prevent the COVID-19 antigen or spike protein to bind to this receptor binding domain. So in that cases, they help to mitigate the disease. But whenever it is getting this convalescent therapy, whenever it is getting the emergency authorization, use of authorization to use as a therapeutic approach, then there are so many debates, there are so many controls, there have a look on these clinical trials. So they are doing on these specifically convalescent therapy. Here I have taken the sources clinicaltrials.gov. It is might be updated in 2021, but it is also more recent. So many countries have participated in the clinical trial. I have seen some Indian reports that is they have published in 2020 in New England Journal of Medicine, a British medical journal. They said the futility of the convalescent therapy, Indian publications. Some publications are there, they are very far, they are just pioneering in just popularizing that convalescent therapy should be the ultimate approach. So much debates are going on. So the thing is that they said that I feel that these randomized or non-randomized clinical trial reports should come, because without the inconclusive results, without the recruitment of the volunteers for the convalescent therapy, I know that whenever other day I was reading, I have seen that NIH also made a halt of a clinical trial that recruiting some 20,000 patients, they made it halt because the most of the volunteers, they did not maintain these stringent recruitment criteria. So they presently NIH guidelines, they do not say anything, say for or against of it. So due to the low recruitment of the volunteers. So these are the two important Journal of Clinical Virology, challenges with the CP therapy, and some frequently asked questions. So Journals of Clinical Virology, they said that this convalescent therapy is very effective, because we know that in the first week of the infection, viremia takes a peak. In the second week, it develops the immunological reactions. So that is, it is very fatal. Cytokine storm in our lab, we get ferritin, some thousands, some 14,000, 15,000. In case of the D-dimer, which is related to the hypercoagulability of the patients, hypercoagulation parameters, D-dimer, so if it is greater than 1,000, it is very, very risky for the patients. In our lab, we got 6,000, 7,000. So you can see that prominent symptoms of cytokine storms are there. And so they claim, Journal of Clinical Virology, so they put letters to the editor that though CP thing is that cytokine storm, it is getting medicated, but there are some challenges, and so you need to, because acquiring the CP from whom the convalescent plasma is taken, the age, health, consent, amount of CP requirement, this has to be normalized, it has to be standardized. Moreover, we know that this 1:160, that should be the ratio of this NAT, neutralizing antibody titer. Many times in many centers, they are giving the convalescent cell plasma without checking the antibody titer. So it then comes to the ineffective. My conclusion is that without having these conclusive reports on the efficacy of the plasma therapy, so you should take a second thought before administering that. And the last point is that need of blood transfusion, whether COVID-19 patients, in which cases they required blood transfusion. So we have seen in our hospital also, I inquired that the patients with showing the hyperfibrinogenemia, hypercoagulability, or DIC, or the patients, they are giving, they are basically on the ECMO, that is tracheostomy, extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. So these invasive procedures, the patient might bleed, and in that cases, they require the transfusion. So this is all about that. And I acknowledge deeply our secretary and this the blood bank senior technologist and other the blood bank officials and the blood bank in charge. I also thank my students and my senior junior technologists for extending their help to make the preparations. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.
Thank you, madam, for such an excellent deliberation, which I think is very much valuable and relevant, not only in this pandemic situation, but all the time. I now hand over the responsibility to Dr. Mohua Guho for conducting the question answer session. Dr. Guho, please.
Thank you, convener, madam, for handing over the microphone to me. We have a question from our IQAC coordinator, sir, Dr. Kuntal Chattopadhyay. Keeping all the discreet and rigorous guidelines, don't you think that the blood donation camps here and there in the localities should be more closely monitored?
Yes, sir. Thank you for your question. I think it should be closely monitored. Unfortunately, it's not being monitored, but we should take the responsibilities and the blood bank. The here two things I would like to share, that we should not encourage, though it is a social responsibilities, that everywhere now and there, every club, everywhere the blood donation camp is being organized without maintaining the this criteria. So it should be closely monitored, and we should not encourage to donate blood anywhere, there where it is not strictly maintained, where the standard procedures are maintained or conducted by the reputed organizations. See, our hospital, they organize this blood camp every month twice. So not only my hospital, there are very eminent hospitals, or there are very good hospitals who had a very good command over the maintaining or monitoring the stringent control over the blood donation criteria. So we should attend and donate blood to that camps only. Otherwise, it is not encouraged to donate blood, because it will unnecessarily cause hazards to the blood bank and as well as to the patient.
Thank you, ma'am. We have a question from Dr. Shubhajit Bandyopadhyay, Department of Botany. What is the time interval for a patient to donate blood recovered from COVID-19 infection?
COVID-19 infections is there. So they have said that at least 6 months. So they should defer their, if it is the patient is COVID-19 infection, so they have said that after 6 months, you can say that after monitoring the all vital parameters, so then they can give. The considering the antibody titers and all things, they can, whether checking their viral load, everything, whether there is any viral load, so which is the lesser than the threshold value. So in those cases only, they can at least 6 months, they cannot give.
Thank you. Our next question is from Professor Anshuman Sarkar, Department of Computer Science. How long one has to wait to donate blood after receiving second dose of COVID vaccine?
See, after receiving COVID vaccine, this is a question I don't know, because it is difficult, because in the standard guidelines, COVID second vaccine is now is a very, very present scenario. Most of us have not got it, but so I cannot give you the correct answer. Maybe I have to go through that consult the standards, because in the written standards, in it's a new one, it is not there. Maybe it will come, or it, they might have incorporated that. So you need to look that after having the second vaccination, so when you can give. But I feel logically that whenever second vaccination is there, so I am all protected against COVID vaccination, COVID-19. So if I fulfill all the criteria of the blood donation, then for me the chances of transmissibility of the COVID-19 will be less. So we can donate blood, but the interval that has to be followed by the standard guidelines, that presently it's not recorded. So I cannot say the specified window period or the time interval when a person can get. But for me, they can give within 2-3 months, because the titer is already high and there shouldn't be any problem.
Thank you, madam. We have a question from Shutapa Roy. After suffering from COVID, what are the parameters to make a person eligible to donate blood?
After having COVID, what are the parameters to donate blood? What exactly you want to know? It's not, the question is not clear for me.
Basically, she may be asking when can the person donate blood next time. That I think you have already answered.
I have already answered.
Yeah, so we can move on to the next question. It is from our convener, Madam Monidipa Dattagupta. What additional precautions can be taken while transfusing blood in the pandemic situation?
See, the thing is that the additional thing is that, see, I have already discussed that there is a the most important point is that before blood transfusion, we need to take or collect blood from the donors. So the first come the donor selection. So there are some challenges. So we need to monitor from the donors. We need to follow up the donors, because we never know the person, the random person who has satisfied all blood donation criteria and donated blood to the blood donation camp. But we never know whether that person is already harboring the disease. If it is there that within 3 days or 4 days that donor started showing symptoms, but he has already contributed his blood to the blood donation camp. So in that case, I have seen many papers also on that. So the most important thing is that the blood bank should take a rigorous follow-up on the the blood donors, and follow up blood donors whether they have some symptoms or whether they have exposure. This is all about blood donation. Secondly, they have to be while transfusing, so then it is very much high chance of if it is viral load in the hospitals are very much, because most of the hospitals now admitted by government compulsion COVID wards. So, and airborne things, these breathing trouble, the oxygen shortage, this kind of symptoms are very common in COVID-19. And mouth-to-mouth resuscitation or this intubation or other things that invasive procedures the doctors do, in that cases there is a high chance of releasing virus directly to the environment. So the safety lies with the close monitoring of the donor selection. Safety lies with the close monitoring of the transfusion reactions. And safety lies with the social responsibility of the donors. So this is my answer to madam.
Thank you, madam. Next question is from Professor Tarok Midda. How is blood bank handling the demand supply chain in the blood bank?
Pardon, madam, just repeat it.
In the COVID situation, How is blood bank handling the demand supply chain?
Okay, so the thing is that in my hospital, I can say first of all, that the I have not seen the slide that COVID, how they are handling. It's a very good question, sir. So thing is that firstly, I need to know that how much blood transfusion is required for COVID-19 patients. So I haven't seen, though I have included the slide, it is written, they have done an observational study, a COVID-19 patient, hospitalized patients, that only 4% for they requisite for the WBC or 1.4% for platelet. For COVID-19 patients, blood transfusion requirement is not that much high. So blood bank is not that much handling the pressure for delivering blood products to the blood COVID-19 patients. Second important thing is that most of the surgeries that could be delayed or deferred, so they are delayed. They are postponed. So in that case, is the requirement of blood in those surgeries might be minimized. Number three is that in that way they are doing these. They have selected the areas of the where it is safe areas or whether the transmissibility ratio of the COVID-19 is very low. The blood banks are working on that to they. But they are making the rigorous control of selecting the area. They have made more stringent, more or less there, it's not that much. Yes, there is a shortage of supply, but in this way, minimizing or postponing the not required essential surgeries. So they are handling in this way. For COVID-19 patients, transfusion is less than 1 to 2%. So for COVID-19 patients, blood demand is not that very much high. So in that way, they are handling the pressure.
Thank you, madam, for patiently answering all the questions from the audience. Now I request our IQAC coordinator, sir, Dr. Kuntal Chattopadhyay, to extend his vote of thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mohua madam. Am I audible to you?
Yes, sir. Okay.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Thank you very much. So this has been a very amazing session indeed. It is customary on my part to move this vote of thanks motion. But indeed, we are all very thankful to our respected speaker for making such an informative presentation on such an important subject in such a lucid and understandable manner. It's really amazing. I would also like to thank our respected principal madam for her constant encouragement and support to all such endeavors. On behalf of IQAC, I am very thankful to the NSS unit and all the members of the NSS unit for their collective hard work. I also extend my congratulations and thanks to the IQAC members for their participation. We are indeed thankful to the technical team members for their dedicated support, as before, as always. And last but not the least, I express sincerest thanks to all the participants this evening for being with us to make this webinar a success. I would like to hand over to Principal Madam for the closing remarks, but I am not very sure. Would you please have a check and tell me if Principal Madam is still there, because she wrote in the chat box that she was having some network problem. She might have been left from the meeting. If you please have a check and let me know. In that case, she advised me to conclude this session on her behalf. I'm not very sure if she is still there. Can anybody check and let me know if Principal Madam is still there?
Sir, I think she has left due to poor network connection.
She wrote in the chat box that yes, there was bad weather and network issue. So,
madam, are you there, madam?
Yes, madam. Yes, madam, I'm there.
And principal madam, are you there?
Principal madam is not there.
No, sir.
I think she is not there in the list.
Yes, sir.
As far our intention and advice, since we are right at the end of this webinar, I would like to extend once again all my sincerest thankfulness to the organizers, to our respected speaker and participants. It has been a wonderful session this evening, very useful, benefiting all of us. And since we have discussed the matter and all the relevant questions so beautifully answered, our speaker madam was talking about our patients, and she has shown much greater patience to deliver and to respond to our questions. We are really very thankful to her.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Let me conclude the session. Now it is over. Thank you all.
Thank you very much. Thanks, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, madam. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
And thank you.